Hey everybody, what'd you think of that? Did anybody watch that for the first time? That's awesome. I love that so many people came back to see it. Well, we have a special treat for you tonight. I'd like to welcome up your director, raconteur, Nacho Vigalondo.
It's messy.
Oh yeah. So and you've got a beer in your hand, and I guess I'll start this with.
It's not beer, is the amazing sparkling sake.
Oh, sparkling sake.
Oh. Okay. Small places.
So a really cliche writing teacher thing is to say write what you know. Do you have experience with either kaiju or drinking in your personal life?
I had issues in my life with one of those two elements.
Okay. Tell us which one. So Anne Hathaway, you worked with her, and you get her to kind of be a doofus in some scenes in this movie. Was that difficult? Like, were you intimidated by getting her to act so silly?
It's something that she really wanted to do. I mean, when she read the script, from the very beginning, she was pretty clear the kind of tone she wanted to add to the character. I mean, we were, like, sitting in this table. Sparkling, you know. We're sitting this table in New York. We had a meeting. Me and my partner, Nikari Pina, she's my longtime partner. The company is the two of us, and she and me, we had to travel to New York in order to meet Anne Hathaway. Which is cool. It's like it's Madrid, New York. You have a lunch and then go back to Madrid, which is like okay. This. My life's gonna be at some point. we got this conversation about the script, and I didn't know at the time if she already wanted to play the role. I didn't know if that meeting, because I'm not into the Hollywood thing, I know how the tradition is. So I didn't know if that meeting was like, if we were having this meeting because she wanted to play the role, or we were having that meeting in order for her to decide if I was cool or something. So I spent the whole lunch just should I convince her, or should I just have a normal lunch? Should I try to impress her? Which would be a disaster. And I spent the whole lunch just trying to define what was happening. And when she ended the coffee, she was like, okay, I'm going to tell you which sequence was the one that convinced me to play this role. And she played the last 2 seconds of the film, the goofy face at the end. And so it was like, okay, number one, she wants to play the role. We're gonna make this film because of her. Number two, she nails the comical side of the character.
Absolutely, she does. Yeah. And speaking of
because comedy, what she did on the table was exactly what she does in the film, exactly the same thing.
So Jason Sudeikis. He really got me the first time I watched this. I was thinking, oh, he is a nice guy. And then the turn comes, like, was it hard not to tip that off too early in the script or in his performance that maybe there's more to him?
Well, the thing is, depending on who watches the film, for some people, Sudeikis becomes a different kind of character in the middle. For some other people, the red flags are all everywhere all the time. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like he's waving red flags all the time.
Yeah.
The first half, and it's beautiful that this happens, because that triggers a conversation about what do we tolerate in a movie, about as a normal behavior or what we consider as a problematic behavior. Because when you see romantic comedies, the hero stops a wedding, it's so charming. But you shouldn't stop a wedding in your real life. That's a behavior who is not socially acceptable, which is intriguing how society is based on these rules, but then they make these other movies in which this kind of lovely way of harassment is kind of accepted in romantic films, which is like crazy. It's like, okay, if you like the girl but she's with another guy, you have to persist and wave a lot of red flags. But if your flag is wide enough, she'll find your charms and she'll fall in love with you at the end. Which is really creepy. But we believe in that environment, in that cultural environment for most of our lives. So it's intriguing how we accepted that. Do you remember American Pie?
Oh yeah.
And it's a plot in which they do revenge porn on this foreign student. And I remember watching that movie not so far ago, and it was fun. It was like, oh yeah, of course, yeah. See, they are showing a video of her naked having sex with another guy to everybody, and she has to go back to her country. It's such a big comedy. It's comedy. And that's real. That happened like a few time ago, and it's intriguing how movies change through the course of time, and it's amazing to see what those movies are telling about us.
It's a fantasy element. And speaking of fantasy elements, were the things you wanted to do in the script that you wrote that you just couldn't get to do because of budget or anything?
No. If you know my stuff, I tend to think in small terms.
Yep.
The movie's bigger than what I wrote. Because they were like, okay, come on, let's just give us something else. Just like, I mean, the real script was much more dry.
Yep.
Not because it's part of my nature, it's because when I wrote it, I didn't know that it was gonna be a movie made in Spain with actors who are close to me. I never expected this movie to be starred by Anne Hathaway.
And your movie's Time Crimes and Extraterrestrial, and you did a time travel movie that's really about other things, and the alien invasion movie, which I saw you introduce, you said it's about assholes. Like, what happens when regular assholes deal with an alien invasion? So what's next? Kaiju, alien invasions.
What if the next movie is gonna be about assholes dealing with I don't know.
I can't wait to see it.
Assholes dealing with.
I think we can open it up to the audience if there's some questions here. Does anybody have a burning question you want to ask? I saw a hand go
burning
up
question.
Real quick over here.
This is kind of dumb, but so. Jason Sudeikis, like, they all drink PBRs at the beginning. But Jason Sudeikis, when he turns into, when he
that's
becomes a
really
bad guy, he starts drinking Schlitz. And it's like, was that, like, intentional? And
what was okay, here's the key point. I'm from Spain. if I talk about beers, you wouldn't know any of those brands. San Miguel, Cruz Campo, Estrella Morente. Those are my beers in life. So when I moved from Spain to the United States, I'm not able to take care of details the same way. So I believe in people working in the art department. Such a boring answer for a beautiful question. Oh yeah, but when he's drinking the pubs, the Blue Ribbon, it's like, okay, that's the one from Blue Velvet. I'm a David Lynch fan. That's all my relationship with beers. Like, Dennis Hooper drinks Blue Pubs, and Kyleman Ackland drinks Heineken. That's all I know about beers. I'm not a beer guy. I'm not that into that. Just the sparkling sake.
What does drinking sparkling cider say about you? What does this drink tell us about your character?
About my character?
Yeah.
Well, this probably means that I know the kind of male who is always drinking beer.
Right.
A new kind of man. New masculinity.
Another question.
Sparkling
sake.
Speaking of assholes in strange situations,
like us in the situation you mean?
No. What do you think the Trump presidency will do for cinema in the future?
It's gonna be exciting. I mean, it's already been exciting, I think. Trump is not only going to trigger interesting films; he's making other films become better. I mean, I got some benefit from the Trump administration in this film, the way the movie is understood. It's the same with Get Out. Get Out was written under the Obama administration, and now it's here, and it has a complete different size when you see it because of the Trump administration. So this is a selfish feeling, but probably Donald Trump is horrible for you, but it's amazing for me. I'm sorry. I'm making films, I'm inspired by reality, and I'm white. So there's no wrong size if my relationship with Donald Trump. Oh, yeah, but I'm a Latino. I don't know, a Euro Latino. I like a pale Mexican. I don't know.
Okay, I see a second to back row there.
You have to love all the process. That's it. That's the advice that I can do. I mean, if you're into this, I don't know. I think there's too many people who want to play films, but because making films is a really specific discipline that is driving you crazy in different ways, and it's not a comfortable way of working because you have to deal with really different stuff and different times of your life. And there's a real big amount of stress. So. I don't like when a filmmaker is into the art process, but he's not that into the acting. Or I don't like when a filmmaker loves to deal with the camera, but he doesn't give a fuck about the script. I feel like you have to love all the process, and you have to be respectful towards all of them, and you have to be intrigued about all of them. Most of the times that a young filmmaker commits a mistake is because he pretends that the craft that feels closest to him is the most important of all. All the most important thing is the art department. And who cares about the script? And you get the opposite thing. I mean, people who are really into the script thing, but they don't care about the camera because it's just, okay, this is the key thing. You have to at least be curious about all those processes. And think about the red flag stuff. And I'm sorry for this movie bringing stuff from real life. Every time that somebody's like, okay, this story really resonates with my life, and I'm like, I'm so sorry.
All right, the middle.
As we were just talking about, there's some dark themes in here, right? Alcoholism, abuse, stuff like that. Do you think that the extreme fantasy element of the kaiju give us as an audience enough distance from it that we don't end up feeling bad? Like, if this was just a story without the kaiju, where abused friend ends up killing her abuser, would we be leaving with the same good feeling, or does the kaiju kind of give us a way out?
So you asking me what came first?
Yeah.
When I was making the film.
Sure.
Yeah. Well, I think he's saying, like, if you wrote it as a straight drama, it would be too depressing. But by adding the kaiju element, it gives the audience something else to distance themselves a little bit from
what if I'm writing this dark drama about abuse and alcoholism and just writing it, just characters like it was like a Eugene O'Neill piece, like Tennessee Williams, and then write one draft and second draft and the third draft, something is not going on well, wait a second, a kaiju, that's what I need here. those things are not separated. I mean, okay, I'm gonna confess something. I got a device in my head about making a movie about people who have to deal with the fact that a kaiju is doing something on the other side of the world. But the idea is there, but it didn't become a potential film until I found what was happening in this film, at the core of the film. There's no a version of this film in which it's just about the kaijus. There's no a version in which it's just about the alcohol. One thing just pushed the other. This movie is about adults fighting early in the morning in a park while the monsters are destroying the city. Okay, then comes the decision. What if the main character is a woman? So she's fighting with a male. So it's about a woman and a man fighting, which is a little bit the stakes of the film. So it's when a man and a woman are fighting. The next thing that you need to find is the reason why they fight, and the reason comes like this: they fight because of this, and suddenly the movie becomes this thing instead of just a popcorn comedy. One thing takes you to the other. I cannot imagine a version of this movie without any of those elements. It wouldn't make sense. I remember that initially, when I was even before writing, I was like, okay, because that's the way it works. I mean, initially you think about the main character. So these two guys are fighting. And what's the reason they fight? And because you're a male writer, and I was born in 1977, the way my brain works is like, okay, this is a male fighting with another male, and what's the reason they fight? Is they're fighting for a woman. That's the way it works. It's like, okay, this can be funny. This can be like a crazy comedy, but this is something that feels rusty and feels really, really out of time and repetitive and boring. And what is it? What is the story about this theme that is around us all the time? And they gave me the chance to make a story. The way this movie was unfolded gave me the chance to talk about domestic abuse in a way that respects, from my point of view, I don't try to impose my views, but from my point of view, sometimes when you're dealing with the situation around you, I have this situation with my husband, I have a situation with my boyfriend, this happens all the time. And these victims are not stupid people, like, fall in love with monsters. Things seem to be okay, they slowly turn into something different. And when you're having this situation, you're like, you're addicted to a person somehow, for the good and the bad, and you have having this kind of, your dependence in this emotional level. So I wanted to make a movie in which the evil abuser is not a monster from the very beginning. It's just the way it works in real life. I mean, you're gonna be, I wanted to betray the audience in that sense. You don't want Jason Sudeikis to be the bad guy until it becomes, the same way in real life, you don't want your boyfriend to be evil, but it can happen. So I don't know, I'm sorry. Well, I was expecting this.
Alright, I see. Oh, tall hand in the second of the back row there.
Actually, I don't have a question. I just want to say I am a non-practicing alcoholic, and thank you so much for making this movie.
I'm sorry that while you're saying that, I wasn't listening.
No.
Right. I'm sorry.
I really did. And it's not just because I'm an alcoholic, and I can imagine somebody doing that to me. It was that anybody would ever try to play on somebody's addiction to that level, and I know it does happen, and it is a kind of abuse. And just thank you so much.
Oh yeah. Oh, the thing is, I don't think that he's fully aware that it's like these guys that they are not fully aware of what they are. I mean, you're self-aware, but these characters probably they are not. Especially, I don't feel that he's self-aware of him or her being alcoholic at all. But yeah, he's using something that is clearly her weakness. Like, okay, you feel guilty as hell because you did that thing, so I want you to put it in that sense, yeah.
Associative element with the kaiju, it reminded me of drones, right? Killing people thousands of miles away and how you have these two different people reacting quite differently to sort of the gravity of what you're doing without having to.
Yeah, it's interesting. It's really interesting. But what I had in mind at the time was the internet. I'm obsessed by how the internet is what it's turning us. And I made a movie called Open Windows, which is a literal movie about the internet. I mean, the movie's a long shot in front of a computer screen. I don't want to do that again, but I want to, I kind of like the idea, I kind of like to explore and swim into the fact that the internet is giving you the chance to hurt people who are far from you, and it really quite easily. Something fascinating. Why is it so easy to insult anybody on Twitter, but nobody will ever insult you that way in an email? That's interesting. Nobody's aggressive on email. But I remember moments in which I surprised myself being aggressive on Twitter. Like, this guy is telling me something that I find upsetting, and just I'm aggressive to the guy. And then I'm like, oh, how I never allow myself to be aggressive to anybody in real life. So what I'm allowing myself to be like this? Such a powerful, creepy weapon that we have there. And people are harassed, and people are harassed every day, and people are suffering every day. And it's a hostile environment for too many people. And it's the fact that you have this amazing weapon that allows you to be in contact with people, with persons who are far from you, people whose faces you don't see. If you are this kind of person, you are going to have a lot of fun trying to hurt other people, because you are this kind of casual sociopath. I don't know, there's no other way to describe it. I mean, when somebody wants to hurt other person through social media, that person is a sociopath. There's no other way to describe it. If you want to hurt other person with no empathy at all on your side. So you have the same weapon to destroy other people's, or try to destroy other people's. Some other people are like, will never do that. So the weapon is the same. I wanted to, you know that I tried to explain something, but I never finished this. Because it's something that is lacks any kind of solution. It's something that we're living in. So I just wanted to talk about doing things and not having any kind of empathy for the consequences of your acting, because you're selfish and you're broken. I mean, and you're depressed. Mm-hmm. And sometimes this is a really horrible thing, but sometimes being depressed turns you into a bigger asshole, which is really cruel. Like, no, you are depressed and you are an asshole, and both things. Yeah.
You want to make other people feel what you're feeling.
Yeah, somehow, yeah, it's everywhere.
So we have time for two more questions here. I see in the middle here.
Can I just say thanks for not completely spoiling everything in the trailer?
It's not my talent. You have to talk to the neon people. They just wanted to. It's a dangerous game. You appreciate that, but other people are like, okay, what? This is not the movie that you've been announcing. I personally, as an audience, I want to leave the theater surprised and shocked and betrayed by the movie that I'm watching. I like the idea of being betrayed by the movie that I'm watching. But I understand that this is a legitimate way of thinking. I think it's legitimate to expect the movies to be what they seem to be what they like, what they look like. Okay, when I want to see Pirates of the Caribbean, I want a Pirates of the Caribbean film. I don't want Johnny Depp to have a 3-minute monologue in the darkness, like in black and white. I just give me Pirates of the Caribbean. Okay. And I totally understand both ways of thinking. But I know a lot of people felt angry at the film because they just wanted to see something that the movie isn't.
Nobody in this room.
Oh, that person in this room is just like, wait until go to Twitter. he will know. He will know what I feel right now. I know I'm laughing, but dear Twitter, I have to tell you something.
Anyway, one last question to close out the night. Make it a good one, right?
Why choose Seoul as the other location?
And let's do another question. Because the answer is really boring.
Okay.
It's a budget thing.
Second to back over there.
So I feel like the core concept of her like controlling a kaiju in another country, I feel like if you explained it too much, it would have kind of lost all of its mysticism and fantastical elements of it. But I feel like if you didn't explain it at all, I feel like it would have felt a little bit too ambiguous. So I really like how you found a happy medium of like explaining why this is happening, but not going into the nitty gritty of what how this happened.
What if I try to explain the whole thing? Like, you know what? Sometimes in these kind of films, there's an explanation, is pseudoscience.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Pseudoscience. You know what pseudoscience is? Pseudoscience is pseudo magic. I can because when you are like in the genesis of the project, when you are beginning with the whole thing, and you don't know where how the movie is gonna feel like, you are toying with the idea of having an explanation for this, but it's gonna take a lot of time. It's gonna take a lot of energy from the film, and I don't think that's that kind of film. I don't feel like when we see the flashback, I have to explain from a rational point of view what's happening. I feel like I have to add some emotional context to the origin of this story. Like, okay, this thing has happened since ever, and basically she's really angry at something that she saw. That's...
And he was a monster then.
She was a monster then. The same way we all gonna be monsters later tonight. At the karaoke rooms at the Salsa Mar. Meet you there later. I cannot wait to go there.
You heard the invitation, so you guys come back to the karaoke rooms to be monsters. And thanks for coming out. Thank you, Nacho.
Thank you so much.